Ladies and gentlemen, I am indeed very grateful to the organizers of the 61st Pugwash Conference for asking me to participate in this very prestigious event. I would like to express my very special thanks to Professor Paulo Cotta Ramosino, who honored me by extending the invitation. As Director General Strategic Plans Division for over 15 years in Pakistan, it was my responsibility to plan and oversee all aspects of Pakistan's nuclear program comprehensively as a single focal point in Pakistan. In that capacity, besides numerous other aspects of the nuclear program, it also fell within my domain to follow and remain abreast of emerging trends and thoughts on the international think tank circuit, as well as major seminars and conferences related to the nuclear field, especially in as much as these had a bearing on Pakistan. It was therefore but natural that I regularly followed with great interest and respect the proceedings, ideas, and recommendations that were discussed at the various Pugwash conferences over the years. It was very satisfying for me to note each time that the noble objectives of the Pugwash conferences were invariably in line with the most basic aspirations and objectives of mankind in general, and in many ways with the aspirations and objectives that I and my colleagues were trying to attain in Pakistan. At the bottom of it all, I found convergence in a number of areas, though sometimes differing in the methods. In this context, as an example, I would like to quote from Professor Paulo's prepared remarks on the 3rd of April this year at the Nagasaki Memorial Hall, and I quote, "Taking into account the last series of considerations, we can understand why Pugwash has since some time been devoting its modest capabilities, energy and efforts in dealing with the issue of conflict resolution and conflict prevention in situations where nuclear weapons are present. In order to prevent a nuclear catastrophe in our times, it is of paramount importance to suggest mediations, dialogue, and mutual understanding between opposite front in situations where nuclear weapons are or may be present. This is why we usually describe the activity of Pugwash as promoting dialogue across the divides," unquote. May I say that the foregoing passage from Professor Paulo's remarks is in line with the thinking in Pakistan at the popular level and at the government level. In Pakistan, there is no doubt in anyone's mind that conflict resolution of the major issues between India and Pakistan is the only sane way forward to ensure peace in South Asia, and that the promotion of dialogue is the path of sanity. Conversely, a refusal to talk is most unwise and a sure recipe for friction and potential disaster. At another place on the website of Pugwash, I saw the following words, which are important. And again, I find these close to the Pakistani way of thinking. And again, I quote, "We create opportunities for dialogue on the steps needed to achieve that end, focusing on areas where nuclear risks are present. Moving beyond rhetoric, we foster creative discussions on ways to increase the security of all sides in the affected regions," unquote. And lastly, I couldn't but agree wholeheartedly with Pugwash's selection of this Nagasaki conference's voice, "Remember Your Humanity." The Nagasaki voice has complete resonance with Pakistan's voice because the unresolved conflict in South Asia is all about humanity and finding a humane resolution to the unfinished agenda of the partition of 1947. I refer, of course, to Kashmir, which cries for resolution on the basis of humanity and humaneness, as pledged by India, Pakistan, and the United Nations. To recap, ladies and gentlemen, what I have said so far, drawing from the Pugwash's way of thinking, A, there is complete convergence of views on the importance of conflict resolution. Conflicts in South Asia must be tackled boldly and resolved. B, there is complete convergence of views on the paramount importance of dialogue, mediations, and mutual understanding as the way forward for conflict resolution. There is no other way and no running away from it in a region where nuclear weapons are present with nuclear risks. And C, while striving for the attainment of the foregoing objectives, there should be due consideration for Nagasaki's voice. Remember your humanity. Ladies and gentlemen, having highlighted the points of convergence in our mutual thinking, I would like to take this opportunity to talk about some related issues with reference to the presence of nuclear weapons in South Asia and Pakistan's outlook on these. I start with the fair assumption that the audience of PUGWASH conference is familiar with the issues in nuclear South Asia, which are the cause of tensions and conflicts. The core issue that remains unresolved, as we know, is that of allowing the universally accepted right of self-determination to the people of Jammu and Kashmir, taking into account the commitment for a plebiscite by India, Pakistan, and the UN Security Council, in the spirit of humanity and humaneness as is being advocated here. In the absence of a just resolution to the conflict, and with unsuccessful attempts to sweep the issue under the carpet for the last 68 years, peace, security, and strategic stability in South Asia have remained and will continue to remain elusive or tenuous at best. Over the years, other disputes have also been added to the Indo-Pakistan conflict dynamics, and these include primarily the issue of Pakistan's due share of the water of the River Indus, which threatens to convert vast tracts of fertile lands into desert. It is an issue of atomic survival of Pakistan. The meaningless occupation of Siachen by India at great cost in lives and materials to both India and Pakistan, a dispute that has been ready for resolution for a long time. The Sur Creek issue, which again is more of an irritant, resulting in miseries for fishermen on both sides. Pakistan has presented recently to the UN and the US government a dossier of evidence of Indian interference and support to insurgents in Balochistan and Karachi with a view to supporting terrorism and destabilizing Pakistan. In the presence of operationalized nuclear weapons with both India and Pakistan, the international community is quite justified in labeling South Asia as a nuclear flashpoint. Ladies and gentlemen, it is important to recall that India dismembered sovereign Pakistan in 1971, and then conducted its first nuclear test in 1974. Pakistan's security was thus doubly threatened. Pakistan had no choice but to commence its own nuclear pursuits. India, and then Pakistan in response, conducted nuclear tests in May 1998, in effect bringing about strategic balance in an environment of conventional asymmetry in South Asia. Unfortunately, the newly established strategic balance was once again unacceptable and frustrated the conventional operational capabilities of our eastern neighbor. Soon afterwards, therefore, new warfighting doctrines were formulated by them in order to find space for conventional war, despite the mutual nuclear capabilities and their inherent dangers and risks. Budgets were and continue to be heavily jacked up in attempts to increase the conventional asymmetry between India and Pakistan, further compounding Pakistan's response options to the provocative warfighting doctrine of Cold Start, also renamed Proactive Operations. Let me very briefly explain the underlying concept of the Cold Start doctrine for ease of understanding of the Pakistani response. The essence of the new Indian military doctrine is that from a traditional mobilize and hit strategy, which was around for over three decades, India has developed a time-compressed hit-and-mobilize strategy, thus altering adversely for the Pakistani military the time, space, and relative strength metrics in an attempt to achieve surprise, inflict spatial and forced losses on Pakistan, while purportedly staying below Pakistan's so-called nuclear threshold. If ever there was a doubt among some apologists about its veracity and adoption by the Indian Armed Forces, it was laid to rest in September this year by the Indian Army Chief when he said that India was prepared to fight a short and swift war against Pakistan at short notice. This statement was followed by the announcement that India's heavily mechanized strike force, comprising of nearly 30,000 troops, will be conducting exercises on the Pakistani border in October-November this year to practice the doctrine under nuclear, chemical, and biological environments. This, of course, will not be for the first time. Such military exercises are being held regularly since the introduction of the Cold Start Doctrine. The Cold Start Doctrine envisages that in case of another Mumbai-like terrorist incident, the Indian Army and Air Force will mount immediate punitive strikes against Pakistan within 48 to 96 hours at 8 to 9 points of attack all along our eastern border with brigade-sized independent battle groups or IBGs, followed rapidly by follow-on forces from deep within India to enlarge the penetrations and present Pakistan with a fait accompli of loss of substantial territory and serious force degradation in quick time, all the time claiming to remain below Pakistan's nuclear thresholds. Thereafter, India will presumably dictate terms to Pakistan from a perceived position of strength. No thought whatsoever has been given to establishing first whether indeed Pakistan was behind those fictional terrorist attacks or not. In my talk at the Carnegie Endowment, Washington earlier this year, I had called the Cold Start Doctrine a pre-programmed, predetermined, firing from the hip concept. It is highly presumptuous, adventurous, and dangerous. Ladies and gentlemen, however, impractical and naive though it might be, the adoption of the war-fighting Cold Start Doctrine by nuclear India against a nuclear-armed Pakistan is not only a reality but also an attempt to destabilize what for some years has become a fairly strategic, stable environment post-May 1998 nuclear tests. But more recently, with the coming in of the BJP government, the tense politico-military environment is now being subjected to unprecedented strain through a variety of provocations and juvenile muscular behavior, unbecoming of a responsible nuclear power. I put it to you, in an unstable political strategic environment where a basic human conflict like Kashmir, emerging conflicts over water, dams, barrages, and lesser conflicts like Siachen, Greece continue to fester and remain unresolved, the two militaries sit eyeball to eyeball on the Kashmir line of control and Siachen. Both countries possess large numbers of nuclear weapons, and where the will and the vision to address the larger issues of peace and security are largely absent, what is one to say when one party is continuously running away from dialogue and conflict resolution, making attempts to find space for conventional war despite the other party's well-known nuclear capabilities, supposedly trying to remain below Pakistan's nuclear threshold, indulging in meaningless political rhetoric and unleashing the genie of religious hate. That it is playing with fire, that it is poor strategic thinking to consider that it can get away with starting a conventional conflict and not invite the other party's strong card, that it is ignoring and avoiding the issues of peace and conflict resolution in a forlorn hope that these will somehow go away. Who determines Pakistan's nuclear thresholds anyway? And why in the first place should there be talk of nuclear thresholds when both countries are fully nuclear armed? Do we seriously think that in this day and age, one nuclear-armed country can prevail over another nuclear-armed country and repeatedly threaten that it will teach the other a lesson? Which planet are we living on? Whoever heard of such immature talk of a Russian or a US, British or a Chinese nuclear threshold? Do these nuclear-armed countries plan provocative conventional military operations against one another while remaining below the nuclear thresholds of the other? Has the thought ever crossed their minds despite Ukraine, the South China Sea, and now Syria? Responsible nuclear powers look for strategic stability while managing their political differences with maturity and restraint. Responsible nuclear powers do play politico-strategic games with one another in their respective areas of competition, influence, or beyond, but do they test the nuclear thresholds of the adversary? Unfortunately, since this level of political maturity and realization has not dawned in our neighborhood, despite a nuclear environment for the last 17 years, Pakistan has had to remain alert and take appropriate safeguards against military imbalances setting in that will disturb strategic stability adversely. Pakistan does not intend to get into a conventional arms race with India. It would be foolish and against economic wisdom. Enough lessons are available from history not to attempt this. However, Pakistan takes the Indian military capabilities, the war fighting doctrine, and its intentions seriously because it has a direct bearing on our security. We are the affected party. The capabilities and the doctrine are meant to be unleashed against us. Therefore, in pursuit of the policy of maintaining robust strategic deterrence, Pakistan will continue to retain effective levels of conventional readiness. In addition to the existing inventory of nuclear-tipped ballistic and cruise missiles, Pakistan has developed a variety of short-range, low-yield nuclear weapons, also sometimes called tactical nuclear weapons, so as to deter and foreclose the Indian option of starting military operations at the tactical level, as visualized in the Cold Start doctrine, and prevent these from escalating rapidly to the operational and strategic levels. This is the Pakistani defensive deterrence response to an offensive doctrine. For 15 years, I and my colleagues in the SPD have worked for deterrence to be strengthened in South Asia comprehensively so as to prevent war, to deter aggression, and thereby for peace, however uneasy, to prevail. We have worked to create roadblocks in the path of those who unwisely think that there is space for conventional war despite the nuclear weapons of Pakistan. I strongly believe that introducing the variety of tactical nuclear weapons in Pakistan's inventory and in the strategic stability debate, we have blocked the avenues for serious military operations by the other side. That the debate has been distracted toward the lesser issues of command and control and the possibility of their falling into wrong hands is unfortunate, because it has diverted attention from the real purpose of the TNWs, that of reinforcing deterrence, preventing war in South Asia, ensuring peace, thereby creating space and an enabling environment for politics and politicians to reassert, lead the way towards dialogue and conflict resolution, and give South Asia and its people a chance. I therefore like to call these weapons, weapons of peace. However unpalatable, the reality is that nuclear weapons in South Asia are ensuring peace. Over time, as relevant lessons sink in, it is my earnest hope that because of the foreclosure of the Indian capability of using the conventional military instrument as a policy option against Pakistan, there will be a strategic conclusion in India that it is dialogue and diplomacy alone that will have to be redeployed eventually to find lasting solutions to what are essentially political problems related to humanity. It is also my earnest hope that one day there will be a strategic conclusion in India that conflict resolution with Pakistan is in its own interest, and that if that were to happen, it will allow India far greater political space and freedom to emerge and play its due role on the world stage and for sustained economic growth, both of which India so strongly cherishes. It is also my earnest hope that there will be a strategic conclusion in India that Pakistan and Kashmir and the rivers are not going to go away. Geography is permanent, adversaries are not. And India sooner or later will have to confront geography in its own interest and start thinking about conflict resolution and making peace, peace of the brave and the courageous. Propaganda and lecturing on terrorism, using it as an international political whip, repeatedly calling off senior level talks, macho posturing through immature political rhetoric, or lobbing volleys of mortar bombs on hapless civilians on the Kashmir line of control will not bring about peace. Gimmickry cannot be an open-ended substitute for dialogue. It is my belief that the road to genuine strategic stability and India's pursuit of the much sought-after global stature lies through Srinagar and Islamabad. It is, of course, India's sovereign choice whether it comes to that strategic conclusion or not, or whether it will continue to choose the path of bluster, bravado, and suppression, ignoring ground realities and remain embroiled in subcontinental disputes in its backyard. The choice is not for Pakistan to make. Pakistan's policy is and will remain that while striving for conflict resolution and peace in all sincerity, strategic stability will never be allowed to be unilaterally undermined to our detriment. There must be no mistaking our patience and pursuit of peace for capitulation. We will wait patiently for India to make the appropriate strategic choices, but will not be coerced by mindless political or military posturing. Our guard is and will remain up always and every time. However, let me also hold out an assurance that India will find Pakistan ready for a fair, honorable, and equitable resolution of disputes whenever it has made up its mind that it is the right thing to do. We have waited for 67 years, I hope the 1.5 billion people of South Asia do not have to wait for another 67 years or more. Instead of the meaningless, massive nuclear retaliation bravado, it is time to talk of a massive peace process leading to conflict resolution, a peace in which there are no losers, only winners on all sides. That is what statesmanship and vision is all about. Instead of harping on the past, let the Indian and Pakistani leadership rise above fruitless point scoring with the international audience. No amount of joint declarations with distant powers to combat terrorism will bring peace at home. South Asia has made enough of a spectacle of itself before a worried world. The world is neither willing nor capable of helping us. I'm sure they only pity us, if not laugh behind our backs. True strategic stability, as desired by all of us, will, in my opinion, follow the outbreak of peace, not precede it, under the roller coaster political environment. What will prevail before that will only be a fragile and managed stability born out of fear of mutually assured destruction with no guarantees of shelf life. In this context, in order to make a beginning on the long road to conflict resolution with an eventual eye on reducing risks of a nuclear confrontation in South Asia, I would like to reiterate the four-point peace formula presented by Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif at the UN General Assembly last month as a possible ladder of reconciliation. A. Pakistan and India formalize and respect the 2003 understanding for a complete ceasefire along the line of control in Kashmir to be monitored by an expanded UN military observers group in India and Pakistan. B. Pakistan and India reaffirm that they will not resort to the use or threat of use of force under any circumstances, a central element of the UN Charter. C. Steps should be taken to demilitarize Kashmir. And D. Pakistan and India agree to an unconditional mutual withdrawal from the Siachen Glacier. Unfortunately, India dismissed the peace formula or ladder of reconciliation out of hand in less than 24 hours of it being offered. I do hope, however, that with the passage of time and cooler thinking, India may like to reconsider the formula as being reasonable enough to form the basis of the first of a few small steps. It is not inconceivable that larger steps in the future may lead to a structured dialogue leading to conflict resolution in a manner that we will all be able to resonate the voice of Nagasaki and say, we remembered our humanity. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen.